Okay, thank you very much, and thank you to all organizers to have a brave to organize this very nice COCO conference after 10 years. I will be moderating the first session, and we are very good in time, and I would like to announce the first keynote speaker, Pertti Saurola from Finland. I think you all know him very best, and he is always an icon on our conferences, and I think today he will show us again some breathtaking data sets on owls, so please.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. First of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee to give me this opportunity to speak about my long life with the Urals and Donimals. So, David, this was the... No? I hate microphones. And I hope that you can hear me over there. So, I'm a very difficult person also because I wanted to have a remote control, but they didn't have it. But they organized this remote control for me, and I hope that it works. Because I want to be free and not to sit behind the table. So, David Johnson asked me to have a personal approach and then also have some science also involved. And that's why I have this title, 52 years among Urals and Thorniel. Unfortunately, I don't have time very much for the Thorniel this time. My main species is the Ural. And here you see it again. The photographs you see, most of them, they have been taken by one of my very good friends, Olli Saksela. I'm not a photographer. And the question, I added the question why, because that question has been asked so many times by my wife and also by many other people. Why so many decades just with the same bloody animals? And I tried to reply to that question. First of all, I started because of conservation. Finland is the country of forests, but we have destroyed most of our forests. And the Ural was in trouble in the 50s when I saw my first Ural. And also, in that time, we knew very little about the Ural, the biology and ecology of the Ural. So that was also a very important start of my work. Then privilege. It is a privilege to have the opportunity legally to invade in the privacy of the birds. To, we see, say in Finnish, break the intimacy protection of the birds. And yes, as you will. And then the last point was science. As you all know, Ural is a cavity breeder. And here you see one. You see one typical nest site, natural nest site of the Ural. It can be very low, a very good cavity anyway, in a quite big tree. Here is the man who showed me the first Ural nest, and after that I was impressed about the bird because it was hitting me, and so it was great to have a bird which is really defending its nest and so on. Here are some other other nests, typical holes, and most typical is just those chimney-like stumps, which have been unfortunately cleaned from the commercial forests of Finland. You see that it's not very easy time for the nesting in such a nest site. And sometimes they breed also in stick nest, but with a very bad success, at least in Finland, because the normal behavior of the Ural in the spring is just to scrape the clean the ice from the nest, and then quite often the eggs have fallen down through the stick nest. And then we have an extreme a rubbish barrel, which was the only place for the Ural to lay the eggs. Of course, this nest failed. And then another extreme here, the ethical of the house, and this nesting material is one of the most terrible glass wool. You know what it is. But anyway, the nestlings failed. So, conservation. I started to construct nest boxes. They are quite big. And I was happy in the 60s to have the Ural-owls accept those nest boxes. And but after logging, quite many of them fell down, and you have to put the new nest boxes. That's all the time working and fighting against the forest. But the privilege, I go then to the next reason. So, for a man, even, of course, for a young man, and even for an older man, it's always a very nice challenge to ring the nestlings of the Ural. Here is one fledging, almost flying out from a nest, and I'm coming to ring it, but the female is not very happy for that. And she is coming, and I like this picture very much, particularly with the young. And you see that the female is very determined to punish the intruder. And here are the claws, and yes, the female returns, and I'm sorry, it doesn't work. This is my very good friend, an Arthur Ringer, and I have got from him also his ringing data of the nestlings, and also data of the females he has captured. Unfortunately, he is not anymore catching them. And that is an innocent farmer who wanted to have Ural breeding close to his farm, and this is the result. Okay, my protection has been always a fur hat, because when I became the head of the Finnish Ringing Center, I got to know about 5 cases where the Ural female had killed herself in hitting the hard helmet of the motorcycles, hard helmet. And then I sent a message to all our ringers that you are not allowed to wear a hard helmet if it's not protected outside by some soft material. But I have managed with a fur hat, and my dear wife has made from the jeans neck protection, and I'm still here, so no problem. Okay, trapping the females is quite easy with a long butterfly net, or you simply can grab it by hand on the next box, the brave ones like that. But trapping the males is much more challenging, and driving 50 years in darkness, I have had one accident. I was driving when I, in fact, was sleeping. But only damage to the car, no damage to me, and also the damage to the car was only cosmetic. So here is my track, which I developed only before the first this kind of meeting in 87. And David Johnson, for instance, saw this already. Then this patio track, as you call it. So, and of course, I give some extra price, laboratory rats to the female. Already a little bit before that tapping, and then particularly after that. And now, this is just a preview to have my personal soap opera on owls and not on people. Yes. Sometimes my wife was looking from the TV. And now I show you something about one individual, one of my individuals, super male Euroowl 113 116, which I call Papa or Pupia. And here are three nests. 3 kilometers is the distance from the leftmost to the rightmost, and about 1.5 between, from the middle to those outermost. And in good year, all of them have been occupied. And now I see, so the story, which is mainly about this Papa. He entered to my population in 1992, he was ringed as a nestling 4 years earlier, 28 kilometers from this site. And he caused immediately a divorce. You see that Mama was breeding with Yoko, but then when Papa came, Mama fell in love with Papa, but Yoko was lucky enough to capture a new female that year, but next year he didn't have any females at all. The nest box was very close to a road, so every time I was driving on the road, I stopped and asked Yoko, "How are you?" And he always replied to me, "I'm here, but without any female." But then, in the autumn 1993, I did the same, and I was following with the radio both Papa and Mama, and then a female replied in the autumn and was approaching from the east, and then I found out that it was Mama, and it was true. Mama came already in 1993, autumn, back to Yoko, and they bred together in 1994. But Papa became very upset, and I could follow him 15 kilometers away, which is a long distance for the Euroowl during the autumn, and then I missed it. But he came back 2 years later. 95 was a very bad year everywhere. No pairs were breeding here. But Papa came back, and with what success? He was able to capture 2 females. This is one of the altogether 4 cases with Bithynia of the Europe. And he succeeded to do that again next year, 97. And here you see what happened in 96. The red curve is the normal growth of the wing of the young. And these green and white circles, they are the measured wing lengths over there, female A. And those other ones, two of those, and those blue ones, they are the winglings for the female B. And that happened because the papa left the female B immediately when the young hatched and was feeding only the nestlings of the female A. But nevertheless, female B was a brave female and could raise one young of three to fledging stage, but a little bit slower than normal. But anyway, those birds fledged. That was quite interesting that the female alone, she had to leave. For instance, when the young were very small, she was not brooding the young, but still one of those young survived. And now we come back to the, perhaps one of the most interesting stories of this graph. Because normally the young, they disperse at least some kilometers. The average, as you can see later on, is for the males about 16 kilometers and then for the female about 20 kilometers or 27 kilometers even. But what happened here? This Jaska, he was hatched in this nest box in 97. And then this Paavo was hatched in this nest box, 97. So both those sons started to breed in their own previous, or let's say their natal nest box. And Papa was breeding in the middle of those two sons. So I call this dynasty of Papa or Tübia. And what is still surprising, the partners, Jaska, Jana, and Paula, they are sisters from the same nest box, about 15 kilometers away. So the probability of this whole story of Papa is less than zero, because the probability to have a divorce in Europe is very low. The probability of have begun in Europe is very low. The probability to have the male breeding in his natal nest box and another male breeding in his natal nest box, and to get partners to both of these guys from the same nest box 50 kilometers away. So that doesn't exist, but it is true. Okay, and then they continued. Here's nothing else, but anyway, I have continued those verse, and unfortunately, at the moment, all of them have already disappeared. Okay, then I come to the third reply to the question, why? Science. I put that like that because I'm not a scientist. For science, you must make experiments. I have never made any experiments. Of course, to put nest boxes, maybe that's an experiment. To put radios, maybe that's an experiment. But I never have changed the clutch size or brood size or giving extra food or so on. So I have been observant all the time. I have tried to observe the birds, what they do, naturally, without my involvement. And it's Ural is an ideal species because it never deserts. And you see that it's quite difficult to be a difficult person. So the environment where they breed is cyclic because they're cyclic. Prey, both, it's very interesting. And they are lonely residents. You can make proper population study on them without losing too many of them. You anyway lose some individuals, but not too many. Both female and male are. And that's why you can follow life histories of individuals, and you can study population dynamics, productivity, survival, and dispersal. And first I mentioned something which I already had done in 1989. I had an honor by E. Newton to invite me to write a chapter to his book, Lifetime Reproduction in Birds, as one of the first owl studies, which had enough data for that. So, lifetime reproduction success is the number of recruits or fledglings produced during the lifetime. Quite rarely you know so much about the recruits that you have to be happy with the fledglings. And you need to have a representative set of complete life histories. You should know everything they have done during their lives. And focus is on variation between different individuals. And you are interested in components of variation, which are lifespan, clutches per year, eggs per clutch, fledglings per egg, and recruits per fledgling. And you are also interested in morphological, behavioral, and environmental factors affecting this lifetime reproductive success. For instance, body size, nest defense, behavior, breeding phenology, quality of mate, territory quality, and conditions in the year of first breeding. And here, what I then, when I had I had 203 females which fulfilled those requirements. And here you see, here are the number of fledglings here produced by number of females. And the most productive female was one which produced 35 fledglings during her lifetime. And six of them were then later on found as recruits. But most of them produced only an average 8 fledglings during their lifetimes. And some of them didn't produce any. They started to breed, but without any success, 0 fledglings. And then the results tell just what I already said. This means that 50% of fledglings were produced only by 23% of the females. So very few females, in fact, are successful and have a bigger impact on the population. And 50% of fledglings was produced by 6% of fledglings of the previous generation. So very few of the fledglings really contribute to the population. And 50% of recruits were produced only by 11% of females. The strongest contribution was recruitment rate of fledglings, lifespan, and the number of breeding attempts, as you can quite easily suspect. And larger females and those which bred early were more productive than the others. Okay, then some words about the population dynamics. I'm not going to tell anything about this integrated population model with what we are now trying to develop, but some of the of the component. So Ural-Alan and cyclic walls. So bank wall and field wall, they are the most important walls when the Ural-Alan starts to breed. Then later on, the water wall is very important prey item in Finland. So in the 50s and 60s, we used to have a 4-year cycle. So we had low increase and peak, and then decrease before low phases. But nowadays, it has been mainly 3-year cycle. And here you see from my study area something how the walls have been cycling from year to year. This material has been collected by Professor Seppo Sulkava, with whom I have been working. He has identified my prey items, and he has also done this capturing. You see that there are red are from the forest, and blue are from the field, and you see that in the best years, 60 out of 100 trap nights have been successful. So quite good populations in those best years, and then very low, only maybe one per trap has been caught those. And we also had collected data from pygmy owl nest boxes, the cache of the pygmy owls. So the effects of wall cycle on Ural-Alan, it's an effect on number of breeding pairs, laying dates. The Ural-Alan lay about 1 month earlier in good years than in bad years. Clutch size, fledgings per breeding pair, and then also survival, recruitment, and dispersal. I will mention something more of some of those. Okay, here you see the numbers of nests in my study area from 65 to 2015. I didn't update it with the data from 2016. We started with a very typical low increase top phase, but then some years were not very clear what happened. It was partly a 4-year cycle, but then again, in 81, the cycle started up, little down, and so on. But then again, there was a period around the change of the millennium when we didn't have any real bad years, but the bad years were good, and good years were, thank you. And you see then again it started, but just now it's a little bit problematic situation. The 3-year cycle has not been so clear as it should be. The wolves are not always behaving what we researchers tell them to do. Okay, here is an experiment by the nature. Once I climbed when it was a very bad year, and now Ural-Alan were breeding, I climbed the nest and I saw, then there were 4 eggs, and I came down, very strange, so there were 4 eggs, but then on my way down, I realized that they were green instead of white. Okay, they were golden eyes. But still the Ural-Alan was outside and striking me and defending the golden eye eggs. I decided that I had to come back and throw the eggs away after 3 weeks, but this was what I saw. Again, the Ural-Alan female flew out from the nest box and was attacking me, and there were alive golden eye nests. Okay, but it was clear what happened, because golden owl female was not asking them to jump out. They died, and when they died, they became food for the Ural-Alan, and finally there was nothing left.
Okay, but it shows that if there are eggs available, the female had motivation to start to incubate, and to incubate the whole period, and she was also happy with a black, flat-billed nestlings instead of white, sharp-billed nestlings.
Okay. And then variation of blood sizes from mostly from 2 to 8. Out of those 8, only 4 nestlings fledged. So I have had, as you will see, also. Okay, I matched that too. And here you see the clutch sizes are varying with a similar way. The productivity of young can be 6 young per nest. And here I have another experiment by the nature. Somebody of you know, but Steve, what do you see? What do you see here? You haven't seen before this picture. There are some who have seen already. I don't ask them. So, 3 young of the Ural and 1 young of the Tom. So when I visited first time this nest, there was only Ural flew out and 1 small egg, and I measured it. And that's of course possible. There can be small and big eggs of the Ural. But when I came to ring the birds, then I realized that the oldest young was the Tony Owl young, and the rest were Ural young. Okay, and then about the total number of Ural nestlings, you see that it varies very much, and the real top was 2009. And 2005 and 6 were also very good, and that's crucial for this story. But then we come to survival. As you see here, I told yesterday about the traffic and wires. The big part of the Urals died because of traffic and wires. We have several hundreds of traffic accidents of the Ural. And then we made a survival analysis. This is now based to the national data, not only to my data. Here you see the numbers. And here is the survival of Ural, age-specific survival from 68 to 2016. And blue is the adult survival, and then the green down here is first year survival, then second year, and third year, and adult survival. You see that the adult survival has been relatively stable from year to year. It has varied around 85% per year, but the juvenile survival has really fluctuated very, very much. And here you see that the best years were marked with blue, and here you see what has been the survival after the best years, very low. And particularly the best year, 2009, the survival of first year births was the lowest ever. So that has a very important, here is also the same for the Tony, but I will jump. And here you see also the average. Is it?
How much?
Okay. I have to speed up. I knew they advised me not to have so many slides, but I still had it. So, survival of the Ural owl is a little bit higher than the Tony owl, and you see the variation of the first year bird. When a poor year and a good year, there's a big difference. And then we jump a little bit and go to the most important, and this is this recruitment. Here you see the recruitment, female recruits of different years. These are the top years, And then these are the... increasing years. So increasing years, when the population is still increasing, they have produced most of the recruits of the population. And 10 years, it means 20% of the years had produced 50% of all recruits of the population. Okay, and then here I have marked the bottom years, which shows that here are female recruits were fledging. The bottom years have produced quite many young in relation to all young they have been, I mean, quite many recruits in relation to the fledgings of that year. So after the young have fledged in bad years, then the conditions have been quite good and they contribute to the population. Okay, then I jump to the dispersal and I come back to this story, how hard it is to work with the neural hub. Here I was 40 years ago. Here 30 years ago, when we had the first meeting in Winnipeg. 20 years ago and 0 years ago. Thank you very much.
We are